Then I present myself first. I used to work at the Gothenburg University as an oceanographer for 50 years or so. So I have some experience of expeditions. And I have also been in Antarctica together with Matti, by the way, 20 years ago or so. Now I'm retired, but I like new initiatives, for example, like this Sailing for Science, that attracts me. I will talk a little about science involved in oceanography. Oceanography is a fairly young science. People have always known about the sea, of course, but it was always some a very chaotic place, and it was difficult to apply rules on the motions, on the conditions, because nobody knew really how the ocean was constructed. And the first attempt to do something about that was this expedition at the end of the 18th century by Challenger. They were out 4 years and they did a lot of baseline measurements, we say. It was difficult on this time because you had to manage a ship with 243 crew and 6 scientists. So the proportions reflect the difficulties of being at sea for such a long time. When they departed from Britain, they didn't know where they were going. There was no plan. They wanted to measure things and then decide. So we go a little more to the north, a little more to the south. And they did that for 4 years. Here is an example. These are the Hawaii Islands. And the track of the ship, original, is like that. They just went to a place, they stopped the ship, and they were measuring things, gathering water samples, measuring the wind, trying to estimate the drift of the ship, and so on. And they did that. So it's like a necklace. It's data on a string. You can possibly, not even in 4 years, cover all the surface of the ocean, because the ocean is the larger part of the world. So you can't do that. But afterwards, after these 4 years, they started to work with all that data. Of the 6 that scientists on board, the majority were specialists in chemistry. So they analyzed what was in the water, more than water. And they found a lot of interesting things. For example, that water contains a lot of dissolved ions, like salt. We call all of that that is in water, dissolving water, salt. But it's not the same salt that we have in the kitchen, necessarily. They also knew that the density of the water, of the seawater, depends on how much salt you have dissolved in the water, the salinity, we say nowadays, and the temperature. Why did they want to know the density of the water? Because they were looking for a baseline for how to describe the ocean. And they found quickly that if you go deeper, you have denser water. So the weight is larger. So all over the ocean, almost every place they visited, they realized that density increases with depth. That was a very new experience. What does that mean? It means that there exists a baseline. The system is not chaotic. It's not like that, like turbulence. But it's sitting like that with the heavy water on the bottom and the lighter water at the top. So there might be a system then of how the ocean works. So you can imagine sort of a mean state of layered water. But it's not the same layering in all parts. So forces that act on the surface, like wind, like air pressure, like rain or evaporation, or heating or cooling, change the density. And that makes the system behave in certain ways. And since then, we oceanographers have been mainly been occupied with determining density. Martin showed an instrument called CTD, conductivity, temperature, depth, that all oceanographers around the world use to look at the density. And when we have the density, a map of the density, we can calculate the currents and the transport and big things that are impossible to measure in other ways. But they were, they started. This is a much more modern research ship, 3,000 tons. It's much bigger than Challenger also. It's the latest Chilean research ship. It has been working since 2013, and it's mainly used for the coast outside Patagonia, which you see a little bit of Patagonia here, and the Antarctic Peninsula, because the Chileans have a base on the Antarctic Peninsula. It's very modern, it has all the equipment you can wish for. But if you want to go out with that, you have to have a lot of money. The research funds must be, it's very expensive. Well, I said that I found a baseline on Challenger. I meant that I found areas, there are five areas really, that are very chunky, nothing much happens in these areas. The large part of the ocean is like that. If you go down and look at the density, it's the same around a very large area. But on the edges of the continent and on high latitudes, or north and south, you can see there are a lot of patterns. This is satellite images. Satellites complement research ships because they can take, they have a very good horizontal resolution, and they return every day or so and take the same photo. So it has time resolution and it has space resolution. This is an image by a satellite that measures chlorophyll A, it says here. There is a chlorophyll inside the phytoplankton, and that you can translate into biomass, plant biomass. So you can see where we live, there is a lot of plant biomass. in these desert-like areas, big areas, the subtropical highs, there is very little life in general. But there are, along the coast, you can see here, for example, in South America, these are examples where deep water, cold deep water, comes up to the surface with all its nutrients, and you have a very high production very close to the coast, all year round. Same in outside Namibia, outside Northwest Africa, and in California. And on these four areas, a very large part of the annual fish catch in the world is taken. So there are high productive areas, and these are very low productive areas. I am involved in research in Chile since 1984, and I still live there after a year. And in the beginning of the 90s, we were studying the upwelling in the along the Chilean coast that I just showed. If you are going to do that, you like say to you, okay, take this ship. It was new in 1990. It has a lot of winches and CTDs and everything. And you can use that 2 weeks every half year. Yeah. Thank you. So we did that. So we traveled to Chile twice a year, and we were out 2 weeks, and we were doing measurements perpendicular to the coast. But the rest of the time, when you are not there, what happens? You have to know that also. This is a CTD. It doesn't show up very much. It's a very expensive, high-level technical thing that costs hundreds of thousands of Swiss crowns for a thing like that. You can hang it out on the sea on this very thin wire that has an electrical conductor in it. On top it has some water bottles that you can close where you want downstairs. So you hang all this. The expedition depends on this and on that fire outside, and you wait a few hours because it takes some time. So 4 hours down and 4 hours up, and the captain needs to have the ship in a fixed position. It's very difficult. It's not so easy to do with a sailing boat, for example. But these modern ships, they have all the equipment they need, so they stay put while you are doing this. And the picture that come up tells us about salinity, temperature, also there is density with depth. It comes up with water samples for nutrients, for example. And you can attach several sondes to this, for example, chlorophyll fluorescence or daylight or oxygen sensor or something. So you get a lot of information in the vertical. But you have no information what happens a kilometer to the side, of course. So it's just resolutions like that. We also tested a lot of other instruments. This is from Gothenburg. It has also current measurements at the top. So it's a little CTD inside. To complement this, during the time when we're not observing, we had to install moorings, they are called. And they are very common in the world, but it's not so common to have very deep moorings. We had to place moorings at 5,000 meters depth. The mooring consists of something very heavy, 1 or 2 tons of junkyard iron, and a thing called releaser. It sits here. And then there are some glass floats that keeps it up like that. And you can put instruments, all the way up until you come to a float. And very often you have a meteorological buoy at the top that also can talk to the satellites. So you know that it's there. All these things measure while you're not there. So it's very useful. But it's a mess to put it out and take it back again, especially in areas where with large waves. Because it's very heavy and there are sensitive things. If you smash a current meter, goodbye current meter, 100,000 crowns. So it's very sensitive. So there is a picture from the deck of this boat. Two guys are not very happy because it's moving a lot. In upwelling areas, it's always wind. The waves are always 4 meters at least. So it goes on and goes on. So if you want to measure there, you have to have a good boat. If you're handling equipment like this, current meters and things that you have to leave there, you need a very good boat with very good winches everywhere. So we are waiting to find a place with a little bottom to put our gear at 5,000 meters. Finally, we found that spot. What we do first, these systems, you put them in the water from the top. So you start with a buoy, and then a current meter, then some floats, and 100 meters of cord, and more buoys, more current meters, and 5,000 meters must go out. And meanwhile, the boat is doing a slow, big circle. And finally, you have 5 kilometers of things floating in that circle. And then you have to get rid of it. We have come to that point here. There is a junkyard iron, 2 tons of iron, and the last cord. So when it stretches, this one stretches, with the crane they take that and put it into the water. It takes all day. And then it falls, this one, to the bottom. It takes about 45, 50 minutes to fall. And then everything is standing up. Hopefully. So we can go home and go home to Sweden and think about writing scientific papers and things. Until the next time, 6 months later, we go out again and we pick it up, change the batteries, take out the data, and again, more things out. Of course, you have to have a ship that can maneuver a core centimeters, even if it's moving like this. So you have to have very specialized winches, very specialized persons that know about these things. And we have. That was sort of a big science out offshore. I also worked many years in Patagonian fjords. They are very calm environments normally. The fjords are very narrow and long like that. The wind is not a problem. The waves are not never a problem, is it? This fjord is called Rolonkavi, and situated there. If you are familiar with the Chilean coast, this is where Patagonia starts, and then it goes on to Cape Horn. And there have been a need to calculate water exchange in this fjord, because many people want to start aquaculture farms and fill them with salmons and in these fjords, because they are easily accessible to civilization. And they are calm areas, so the equipment for the aquaculture is not weirded out. But somehow you have to know if the fjord can stand a lot of fish farms, because they pollute all the time, the fish farms. Somebody told me that it's like 500 pigs on the float, and they are doing their necessity. Yeah, so it's fish farms are dirty places. The government, what will they say? They like fish farms because it's a lot of work for the people. But on the other hand, if there are too many fish farms, they will destroy the fish farms itself. Yeah. So they ask us to calculate the load that it's possible. How many fish farms can you have in a certain fjord? And then you calculate the water exchange, because you suppose that there are no fish farms, they are in there. So we devised the program, typical. You decide stations for measurements, In the fjord, this is 50 kilometers, and the depth is 400 meters, so it's about 450 meters. But we can take a big ship in there. To begin with, if you have a big ship, and you have you want to measure close to the surface, the propeller of the big ship will mix everything, so you have to wait 2 hours before you make measurements. So it's very impractical to use big research ships. And some places is very small, as it is. Yeah. So you want a smaller ship. This would be ideal. That is a little research ship that belongs to Concepcion University. We have been working a lot, but it can't. It can't go to the south. It's too far, too dangerous for a ship like that. Even if it has nice laboratories and winches and things. So we hired fishermen and their boats. There are many benefits from that. They know the fjord because they have lived there all their life and fishing. They can work 24 hours without resting. So we had to do that also. In fact, we had 30-hour expeditions when nobody could sleep. These boats, they can't even go backwards, so the propeller cannot mix the water. They just stop it and wait for 50 meters and then it stops. So it doesn't mix the stratification of density. And that is especially important in a fjord system where the main water exchange with the area outside is within 5 meters depth. So you need really to have good measurements in the first 5 meters. It's also nice. Students are very happy when they can go with us. This is a Karin from Göteborg. There is filtering chlorophyll from phytoplankton there in the sunshine. This is a CTD we use on that boat. It's much smaller than the CTD you saw on the other ship. And it has no data transmission in the wire. So that means you can use an ordinary boat. But it's still quite heavy if you want to, you wouldn't do that, because it's like 15 kilos. So we had a winch installed on the deck with this nice motor that made all the work for us. That's why it looks so happy, because it's 450 meters down and 450 meters up. When the instrument comes up, you can connect it to the computer and take out on the deck. Well, the boats are very small, so accommodation is not so nice. Maybe claustrophobia? No. Because it's, you see downstairs, it looks like that. We have just managed to buy the Chilean speciality called empanadas. I don't know if you have ever eaten empanadas, but if you're at sea in these conditions, working, it's fantastic to put this on the stove downstairs. And how about the moored systems? Now we have no winches, big winches, but we have a very good cutting and a crane. And we put out the system the same way as we did off the coast. And we have the anchor. And we have this thing that is the releaser. I forgot to mention that before. When the system is installed, you see nothing of it. There is no buoy at the surface. But when you want to recover it, you have a little, just like that, a little transmission in the water, and you press a button. And this thing says, okay, I'm here, like a barcode. And then you press the other button, and it releases this one. and all the instruments come up by themselves. It's a very exciting moment every time. Well, if you have no winches, you have to have a strong tripulation, and these guys were really strong. Yeah. Maybe I should stop there. This is in the bottom of this fjord. You can see a volcano there, maybe, and snow on it. And yeah, I think I had another theme also, but I left you some other time. Is it okay? Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.